Hachette Audio presents We Were Strangers Once, a novel, written by Betsy Carter, read by Suzanne Toren. To everyone from somewhere else. My fellow Americans, we are and always will be a nation of immigrants. We were strangers once, too. Barack Obama. Part 1. In the Old Country. 1.
Remember, he's a busy man. No idle talk. And don't forget to wear your gloves.
When Elizabeth looked up from the street, she could make out her mother's form, still in her dressing gown, standing behind the only unshuttered window on the street. It was early enough that there was no sun, no shadows, nothing except the familiar, harsh voice ricocheting off the cobblestones and whisked away by the frigid February wind. She wanted to shout back, "I don't have to make idle talk. My work speaks for itself." But she had long ago given up on that conversation. Besides, this morning she had no time to waste bickering with her mother. All her attention was focused on one thing and one thing only, her meeting with Germany's most famous naturalist, Professor Rudolf Schneider, who had spent the past 5 years compiling research on the birds of Europe. Now he was looking for someone to illustrate his work, which was, in a sense, what Elisabeth Arnstein had been doing for most of her 21 years. When she had been a few months shy of 8 years old, Elizabeth's father had become so ill that he'd taken to his bed. After school, she would come home and sit with him. Sometimes she'd get under the covers and lie with her head on his shoulder while he slept. It was early spring, and though he appreciated his daughter's attention, even craved it, Bernard Arnstein also felt it was unnatural for a girl Elizabeth's age to be confined to a dark room with a dying man. Knowing what a quick hand and deft mind she had, he'd said to her, "Elizabeth, take your pad and pencils outside and bring back the spring to me." So every day after school, she would go with her sketchbook to the Stadtwald, the largest forest in Frankfurt, and sit quietly in the brush, drawing the foliage and insects and birds around her. At night, she would lay her sheets of sketches at the foot of her father's bed, and he would ask questions. What did the starling's song sound like? Were the fawn's eyes frightened when she came upon you? How did the toad's skin feel in your hand? A jeweler by trade, Bernard Arnstein had spent his days peering through a magnifying glass, synchronizing the mechanics of a clock, or placing chips of diamond just so around the emerald centerpiece of a ring. Patience was his craft, precision his art, and he was eager to instill both in his only child. "You must make us see the light reflect off the loon's back, hear the ruffling of the hawk's feathers. Give them life, Elizabeth, not only pretty colors." Before he died, he gave her a small package wrapped in brown paper with a note inside. "Remember, fresh eyes on the world." The gift was an old prosthetic eye made of hand-blown glass, the onyx-black pupil surrounded by a hand-painted marine-blue iris centered on a porcelain-white background. The eye had been a gift to him from his own father, and he had always kept it on his work table. As a child, Elizabeth had been afraid to touch it because it looked so real, but after her father died, she kept it in the drawer of her dressing table, and at least once a day, she'd hold it in her hand long enough for the cool glass to become warm and the memory of her father's touch visceral. Elizabeth continued her habit of going to the Stadtwald, where she mostly drew the birds. She became so attuned to their songs and habits that she could distinguish the high-pitched tsi-tsi-wit of a swallow from the sneezy tsi-wit of a woodcock. She never tired of watching over their eggs or waiting for the mature birds to come back from their hunt and drop dinner down the throats of their chicks. Sometimes a wren or a starling would stop at her feet and peck at her shoes. They would stare at her with their keen black eyes, and she would feel certain that something had transpired between them. She felt her father in the birds' presence. She was certain they hovered as if they were keeping watch and guiding her. How else to explain why they would stand still before her long enough that she could sketch their forms and memorize their plumage? It was a childish habit, she knew, but this morning as she walked toward the streetcar, she checked the sunless sky for a bird, any sign of one. There was nothing. "All right," she said to herself. "It will be Professor Schneider and me. I hope he's prepared." Defiance was an old friend. It stuck with her when schoolmates taunted and called her bird brain, and saw her through her mother's relentless chiding. "The birds will not put food on your table or keep you warm at night." Every evening, when she returned from the Stadtwald, her mother would grab her hands. "Wash that filth from your fingers. Your hands are like a common ditch digger's." Elizabeth would examine the dusty colors on her fingers. The rosy gray of a pine grosbeak's rump, crimson from the crested head of a great spotted woodpecker, a yellow smudge from a wagtail's belly, her treasures of the day. "Dirt is dirt. You and your father, you live with your heads in the clouds." Her mother never tired of pointing out the ways in which Elizabeth and her father were tethered, as if she was still trying to insinuate herself between them, even after his death. Surely the professor shared Elizabeth's passion. The wind picked up. For all the time she'd spent pinning her hair into a bun this morning, she could feel strands of it coming undone. She pulled her shawl tighter around her head. She had heard that the professor from Heidelberg was an elegant man, even something of a dandy. Then she remembered her mother's warning. "Don't forget to wear your gloves." She dismissed this concern. Surely the professor had better things to worry about than her poor hands. After a 20-minute ride on the streetcar, she got out at Schweizerstrasse and faced a row of old stone houses with pointed roofs and smoke coming out of their chimneys. They were red-brick storybook houses, the kind of places that Hansel and Gretel might have called home. She rapped on number 916, the one with the cast-iron door knocker in the shape of an eagle's head, and was greeted by a chubby-faced woman with cheeks the color of last night's claret.
"How do you do?" the woman said. "You must be Fräulein Arnstein. May I take your coat? Please, sit here by the fire. You must be freezing on a morning like this."
The woman disappeared through a heavy oak door, closing it behind her. Elizabeth sat on an overstuffed chair before the fire, her portfolio in her lap. There was a worn rug at her feet, and on the walls, some of the framed original illustrations from the professor's book, The Wildlife of Central Europe. Published 5 years earlier, in 1885, it had become an instant classic, and Elizabeth had memorized every illustration in it, drawn by the professor's co-author, an older gentleman who'd passed away shortly before the book was published. Now she rose to study the drawings up close. The colors were gorgeous, even transcendent, and the drawings were perfectly composed. But the details were muddy, and the quills on the porcupine didn't look remotely real. "These are beautiful," she thought, "but where's the life? Mine are better." She allowed herself to sit with that smug feeling as she warmed her hands at the fire. There was no need to put on her white gloves, as her mother had warned. Gloves or no gloves, the professor would find her work agreeable. The woman reappeared.
"The professor will see you now. Come this way."
They walked down a long, dark, uncarpeted hallway. Elizabeth was aware of how her shoes clacked against the bare wood, but she had to walk fast to keep up with the woman in front of her. When they reached the office, she pushed open the door, revealing a bright and immaculate room. The stone walls were bare and painted white. The professor sat behind a long table with stacks of paper in front of him and a notebook page half filled with his cursive handwriting. In the same cheerful voice,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.